All right, well, tonight is the 116th Hot Science Cool Talk, as I said, A Taste for the Beautiful by Dr. Michael Ryan. Let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Michael Ryan. He's the Clark Hubbs Regents Professor in Zoology here at the University of Texas at Austin. Mike was born and raised in the Bronx, not normally thought of as a breeding ground for a natural scientist. But nonetheless, he developed a keen interest in biology from many trips to the Bronx Zoo, from many trips to the American Museum of Natural History. And he just liked being outside, and he liked animals. So he knew what that meant for him, is that he was going to become a high school biology teacher. Well, he went to college, and he was made to engage in some research projects. And he discovered he liked research so much that instead of becoming a high school biology teacher, he would go on to graduate school and maybe become a professor and a researcher. So he got his PhD in neurobiology and behavior from Cornell. He then moved on to the University of California at Berkeley, where he was a postdoctoral fellow. And then he came to Austin, Texas, and at 1984. And then he began his position here as an assistant professor way back then at the University of Texas at Austin. You know, Berkeley tried to steal him back about 5 years ago. They made him an offer. We thought he couldn't refuse, but we prevailed, and he's still here. His primary research interests are in the area of evolution and mechanisms of animal behavior. He's a leading expert in this area. He's received lots of awards. Let me just tell you about a few of them. He's a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and he's also a fellow of the Guggenheim Foundation. For a variety of reasons, we rarely have Hot Science Cool Talk speakers come back and give another talk, or give more than one, and Michael tonight becomes part of that elite group that we've asked back. He gave Hot Science Cool Talks number 10 in 2001, and now tonight, we're fortunate to have him here again to give number 116. Please welcome Michael Ryan.
Hey, that's it. So, where'd Jay go? Oh, you're right there. So I want to thank Jay for inviting me back to give this talk. And like you said, I gave one of these talks in, I'll keep talking. I gave one of these talks in 2000. And I bet a third of the people or half of the people here weren't alive in 2001, and for those of us who were alive, all of us are a lot older since 2001, and I feel especially myself, maybe I'm the only one, but I feel certainly that that was a good while ago. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to talk about the theme of this book that I recently published, A Taste for the Beautiful, and this just came out in February, and not my choosing, but it came out on Valentine's Day in February. And si prefiere leer en español, hay una traducción disponible ahora. So you can read this in English, or you can read this in Spanish, or if you want to wait a few months, you can read it in Japanese, and then in a few more months, you can read it in Chinese. So what I'm going to talk about is a very simple question that Darwin asked, and that is, why are animals so spectacularly adorned? And this leads to a variety of other questions. And I'm going to go through, I'm not going to read through this outline now, just to give you an idea of what I'm going to be talking about. Though this idea of animals having these beautiful and elaborate traits caused a lot of questions for Darwin and a lot of questions for researchers that continue to this day. And they also, I study animals, I study animal behavior, but these questions about these elaborate displays also give us some insights into the way we are and the way that we act. So what that little trailer showed you is that we're surrounded by animals that are just amazingly beautiful and have these amazingly complex behaviors and morphologies that a lot of us find just absolutely stunning and awesome in the true sense of the word awesome. And we see this in a lot of different kinds of sensory modalities. We see this in visual displays, in colors, in dances that animals do. We hear this in sounds, whether it's songbirds singing these beautiful melodic verses, or crickets chirping, or frogs croaking. We also see it in light, with fireflies displaying towards one another. And we see it in guppies in the mountains of Trinidad that have these really amazing set of colors. Now, when Darwin started to review all of these really spectacularly beautiful traits, he noticed a few things right away. One thing that he noticed was that these displays usually aren't shared by all the members of a species. They usually, and there's exceptions, I mean, there's lots of animals, there's exceptions, but in most cases, it's usually the males that have these spectacular colors. So if you're bird watching, you know that you would much rather see a male bird than a female bird, because the males are much easier to identify, because there's bigger differences between the species. It's the males that are more brightly colored, and the females are often colored just very much like the background in which they live. So these traits then are what we would call sexually dimorphic. They're more expressed in one sex than in the other sex. And with these kinds of traits that Darwin was interested in, they were usually more elaborately displayed in males than in females. So that's the first thing he noticed. The second thing that he noticed was that these traits all seem to have something to do with courtship, or with males fighting to gain access to females during the breeding season. So these are all what we call sexually selected traits, and I'll come to sexual selection in a second. So what Darwin hypothesized is that these traits are more elaborate in males. They have something to do with courtship. They're usually shown during the breeding season. And Darwin suggested that that females had a taste for the beautiful. What he meant by that is that female animals seem to have aesthetic preferences very much like we do. They prefer these same traits in their males that we find beautiful when we look at these males. So Darwin suggested that because females liked these traits that were exaggerated and so elaborated in males, this caused males to evolve these traits to even more extreme states because it made them sexually attractive to females. So then he had he asked the question, well, why is it more common in males than in females? And Darwin didn't know everything. He knew a lot. He didn't know everything. He didn't really have the answer back then. It took another 100 years or so in the 1970s for someone named Robert Trivers to answer that question. And what these Trivers and other researchers pointed out is that there's a real difference, as we know, between males and females. But the most fundamental difference between males and females are that females have eggs, and eggs are very large, and males have sperm, and sperm are very small. And for fertilization to take place, it needs one sperm and one egg. So there's many, many sperm competing for access to fewer eggs. So therefore, the females were in the driver's seat. The females, when it came to sexual reproduction, the females were the limiting sex. So this resulted in males competing for, fighting for females, and females getting to decide which individuals that they wanted to mate with. Now, there's plenty of exceptions to this pattern in the animal kingdom, and we're one exception. In humans, mate choice is much more of a mutual affair, and there's other animals where there's mutual mate choice, but in most of the animals that we know about, it's the females that get to choose with whom they want to mate. So what that means then is that it's the females that get to decide what's beautiful. Now Darwin made another observation, and this observation really got to him. He wrote a letter to a famous botanist in North America, and as a grain, he said, every time I gaze at a feather in a peacock's tail, it makes me sick. Now, we actually know that Darwin was a hypochondriac. He always thought that he was sick. We also know that he really was sick some of the time. He contracted a lot of diseases when he took his world-round trip on the Beagle. For instance, it seems that he had contracted Chagas disease when he was in South America. So he really was sick for a long time. But this wasn't a physical ailment. This sickness that he felt seemed to come from cognitive dissonance. And what do I mean by that? Well, he had just worked out this wonderful theory, natural selection, that explained how organisms evolve traits that make them adapted for survivorship. And there's lots and lots of examples of that. And one of the famous examples that he studied was the beaks of Darwin finches in the Galapagos. And he showed that different species had beaks of different thickness and different lengths, and these beaks were adapted to feed on certain kinds of seeds. So those were the kinds of traits that Darwin was talking about when he was talking about natural selection. So he has this theory, natural selection. He publishes this book in 1859 on the origin of species. This idea was quite readily accepted by most of the biologists at the time. But now he's starting to see all of these traits like the peacock's tail. And Darwin realized there's no way that a male peacock is going to survive better because of this meter-long tail that he has. So I don't know how many people know where Mayfield Park is. It's on the other, okay. So if you go to Mayfield Park in the spring, they have peacocks that display. And my two girls are in college now, but I used to go to Mayfield Park in the spring to watch the peacocks. And the males will be out there displaying. We realize that the males like to display in sunny parts of the park, so that was kind of cool, all that light reflecting off of these beautiful tails. And you look at these males, and they look like such magnificent creatures. They're standing in front of the females, erecting these meter-long tails, shaking them in the sun, until one of my girls takes off and runs after the peacock. So the peacock runs away. She was able to catch up to it, to grab its tail. So I got the tail out of her hand, And the peacock keeps running away, and then it kind of flies. I don't know if you've ever seen a peacock fly. It's really pathetic. So all of a sudden, you see these magnificent males displaying these beautiful traits, and you think that they're so well adapted for what they do. Well, they are, unless it comes to survivorship. And they can't outrun a little kid. Imagine what a fox would do to these. So that was Darwin's concern. He's thinking, wait, I just explained how animals, how organisms evolve traits for survivorship. How do I explain all of this stuff? So Darwin came up with this other idea called sexual selection. And his big concern was that these traits that females favor actually seem to decrease survivorship. So I'm going to give you an example of a study that we did years ago that shows that these traits really are dangerous, that in fact beauty kills. So I study mostly frogs and fishes and bats. And when I was a graduate student, I was studying these little frogs called tundra frogs, which I'm still studying. And these are in Panama, you listen to their calls. So like many other frogs, what these frogs do is the males come to these breeding pools and they form choruses and they call for females. Now there's about 5,000 species of frogs and almost all of those frogs call. And all of those frogs have a call that's specific for their own species. So the females can listen to these calls and the females know which males are their species and which males are not their species. And there's really strong selection for females not to make a mistake and mate with another species. So they pay very close attention to the call. And I'm going to talk about their brains in a little while. But we know that the brains of the females are wired, so they find the calls of their own males more attractive than the calls of other males. But I want you to listen. It was hard to hear exactly what these calls sound like. So I'm going to play the call again of one male, and we're going to hear that there's two parts to this call. The call starts off with a whine that sounds like this. And a male can make a whine, or he can add these syllables called chucks that sound like this. And they can add up to seven of these, and this is what they really sound like. So the males are calling, they're adding these chucks to their call, and then the females will choose a male for mating. And can anybody figure out what these frogs are doing near this little snowball over there? Go ahead. Taking a bath? No, not quite, but it's close. Can anyone else make it? Yes? They are mating, and what do you think this white stuff is? Do you want to guess? Well, there's eggs in there, and I don't know if you've ever had a lemon meringue pie, but there's this fluffy stuff on the top, and the way that you make meringue is you take a chicken egg, and then you separate the white from the yolk, and you take the white stuff and you mix it up with a fork and it turns into foam. So that's what's happening here. The male is on top of the female. The female just extrudes her eggs and the males take his hind legs and he beats those legs into a jelly matrix, into a foam matrix, very much the same way that we would make a meringue. And then the eggs are inside that nest. The male fertilizes the eggs as they come out. And then they live in that nest for about 3 or 4 or 5 days, and then they hatch out into the water, and they turn into tadpoles. Now, these males can add these chucks to their calls that we just heard. Now, if a male's calling by himself, he makes only a whine. Now, if you go up to this male, and I didn't point out all of these studies that I'm talking about with this frog are done in Panama. If you go up to one of these males who's calling, and if you were to say to him, then he would answer you, And you don't have to be very good at imitating them for this to work. He'll answer you, but he answers, "Yeah." And if you say to him, "Yeah," he answers, "Yeah." And sometimes you can get a male to make three chucks. So we wondered, and this was a very long time ago, we wondered, why are the males adding chucks to their calls? Well, they're at a breeding site. They're trying to attract females. So we thought, well, maybe females like to hear chucks. So we can do this very simple experiment. We put them in a big chamber, a big room, and we have one speaker here and one speaker here, and we put the female in the middle. And then we play calls from the speakers, and the females hear, yeah, 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 and the female just hops to the speakers because she thinks they're males. So it's very easy for us to ask female frogs, what calls do you like better? And what they tell us is they like wine chucks better than wines. 500% more attractive to a female than just a wine. Okay, so now we have a conundrum, a little bit different than Darwin's, and that is, all these males can add chucks to their calls. The males are there to mate and only to mate. Females prefer these calls with chucks, so why are the males so reluctant to add chucks to their calls? And this is the answer. This is a frog-eating bat, Trachopsorosis, and I know that a number of you here know of Merlin Tuttle, who founded Bat Conservation International. Well, when I was a grad student, I met Merlin in Panama, and Merlin had just caught one of these bats with a frog in its mouth. So Merlin and I started talking, and we were wondering if maybe the bats could actually hear the frog call and home in on the call. And they shouldn't be able to do that because bats can usually only hear these very high frequency echolocation calls. But we could do these same kinds of experiments with the bats that we did with the frogs. So we give a bat a choice between one speaker playing only a whine, and the bat flies down and lands on the speaker, trying to get inside because it thinks there's a bat inside. And then we can give the bats a whine chuck and a whine, and the bats are much more likely to go to the wine chuck. Their strength of preference for wine chuck over wine is just about as strong as it is with females. So I'm going to show you a very short video clip, so I have to pay attention, it doesn't last long, of one of these bats. Trachopsorosis is the name of one of these trachops coming down and pulling a tungra frog out of a little pool. You see that they're quite good at it. So this is what concerned Darwin. I mean, this would be as much concern to Darwin if he knew about it as the peacock's tail. So this is a very good example of how these traits that females like so much, that they find attractive, that they find beautiful, are really bad for the males that display them. They're at least bad in the sense that it decreases their survivorship. So there's this tension, there's this conflict between natural selection that favors traits that help you survive and sexual selection that favors traits that make you more attractive. And that was the conundrum that faced Darwin and that he resolved by pointing out that if selection favors traits that enhance mate attraction, they can evolve even if there is a survivorship cost, so that there has to be some balance between these two. So this leads us to the question then, why is it that females prefer these certain kinds of traits in lots of animals? Well, we often say that beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and that statement is certainly true. And what it tells us is that if we want to understand why males evolve these sexually beautiful traits, we really have to think about how the females are perceiving these traits, because it's the females that decide what is beautiful. So if we want to know why males evolve these beautiful traits, then we have to have some idea of how the females perceive them. Now, frogs aren't looking at traits. Frogs are listening to traits. And other animals are detecting their traits through olfactory cues, through smells. So beauty might be in the eye of the beholder, but more generally, we say that beauty is in the brain of the beholder. So if we want to understand the female's preference for certain kinds of traits, we really have to try to understand that through the female's brain. Now, Picasso understood this. When he painted this picture, A Girl in the Mirror, what he's showing is that a girl is looking in the mirror, but the image that she's seeing in the mirror is not really her image. And Picasso asked, kind of rhetorically, you know, who's to say what the actual representation of this trait? Is it the girl? Is it the photographer? Is it the painter? And what Picasso was pointing out is that all of us, within our own species, can have very different percepts of what's beautiful. And that, in us, that really depends on our early upbringing in our culture and our current society that biases our perception of what's beautiful. So I want to talk about these kinds of beautiful traits in terms of visual traits and also in terms of acoustic traits. So after we talk about beautiful sights and beautiful sounds, then we're going to talk about some parallels that we see between animal mating systems and between sexual attraction in humans. So let's think of beautiful sights. So birds especially can do lots and lots of bizarre things in order to attract females for mating. So here's one we're going to see. This is a bird of paradise. And this will go on for almost a minute, but it's just a spectacular display that these males do.
This contender, called the superb bird of paradise, is a magician with a special trick. First, he advertises his show by calling to attract a female. And then, with the audience in place, he begins to work his magic. That's impressive, but she needs to step out for a moment to think. Oh boy, well, not today.
So all of these kinds of traits, I mean, we don't know why that female bird of paradise likes that kind of dance and likes those kinds of colors. I mean, for most animals, we really don't have much of a clue. We only have a handful of animals that we have a very good understanding of why they had their particular taste for the beautiful. But one of them are guppies. So you can buy guppies in pet stores. And all of the guppies that you can buy commercially are descended from wild animals that you can find up in streams in the mountains in Trinidad. And guppies are one of the most variable of all animals. So these pictures here are, this photo shows guppies from different streams in Trinidad. And what we see is that there's just a stunning amount of variation in their colors. And not surprisingly, now that we understand this, what we see is that it's only the males that have these colors. The females are all just very plain colored. So people wanted to try to understand what is it about these colors that make males so attractive. So one possibility is that these colors were telling the female something about the condition of that male. And there's lots and lots of studies trying to show that the amount of orange that a male had was telling the female something about the male's condition. And none of these studies were very successful. Now, we do know that the brain, that beauty is in the brain of the beholder, but we also know that brains have other things on their mind besides sex. So what it ends up here is that these guppies, the males and the females, eat orange fruit. And the photoreceptors in their eyes are biased towards the color orange. And the parts of the brain that generate their motor behavior is biased towards having them move towards orange colors. And they did a very simple experiment where they took these poker chips and put them on the bottom of the fish tanks and asked how much time did the fish spend inspecting these different colors. And what they found was that both the male guppies and the female guppies spent a lot more time inspecting the orange colors versus the other colors. So with this and a lot of other data, the researchers suggested that it seems what happened is that in the guppies, there is really strong selection to be able to see orange very efficiently and to move towards orange because this would bring you towards food. And then the idea is that after these fishes have evolved this bias towards orange because of foraging, because of looking for food, it was then that some males had mutations for orange colors. And when they evolve these orange colors, they're immediately favored by females because now the females notice them right away because their eyes and their brains were already biased towards orange. So this is a case where the females prefer orange because their sensitivities to that color evolved in a totally different context. Now, there's often this entwining of food and sex in lots of animals. And here's another example of how important food is to understand sex in fishes, but it's a very deceptive example. So these fishes are called carassin swordtails, and they're also found in Trinidad up in the mountains. And what we see here is a male on the right and a female. Are you okay? A male on the right and a female on the left. Now the male seems to be holding a shish kebab with a little piece of beef on the end of it. Well, what it is that's one of his pectoral fins. And at the end of the fin, as you can see, there's a piece of flesh, but it's his own flesh. So when a female comes by, the male erects this fin ray, and he moves this piece of flesh at the end of it, enticing the female to come over. So the female sees it, she comes over, she goes to bite it, and the male puts his fin down, and then the male starts to court her. So in this case, it's not that the females are preferring something specifically about this flesh at the end of the fin, but the male's using it to deceive the female, so she will come over to inspect it, and this is when they start courtship. So what we're going to see in a couple of other examples is that males evolve a whole variety of traits that seem to sometimes trick females, sometimes appeal to aspects of the female's neurobiology that evolve for other reasons, like the perception of orange colors in guppies. There's one trick that humans and other animals use a lot in their social behavior, and that's something called a supernormal stimulus. So here's a simple experiment that was done many years ago with gulls. So these gulls, they'll have an egg in their nest. So if you take the egg out of the nest and move it away where the gull can still see it, then what happens is then the parents will roll that egg back into the nest. Makes perfect sense. But if you take that egg and you move it out of the nest, but next to that egg, you put a large ball next to it. Then what the parents do is they ignore the egg and they try to roll back this big ball into the nest. And then they sit on this big ball trying to incubate this ball. So this is an example of, so the ball in this case is an example of a supernormal stimulus. It's called supernormal because it's greater in magnitude than the normal stimulus, and it releases a supernormal response in the animal that it's targeting. So the gulls actually show a greater response to this large ball than they do to their own egg. Now, this might suggest that these gulls aren't very bright, but what's happening here is that for the gulls, under normal conditions, when you don't have animal behaviorists messing with them, if their egg rolls out of their nest, their egg will be the biggest round object that's anywhere near the nest. So instead of having in their brain an idea of exactly what their egg looks like, they just use a shorthand. Just, if my egg's gone, look around, and the biggest round object near the nest is going to be, the egg. But the fact that we all have responses to these supernormal stimuli leave our senses open to this kind of exploitation. And the animals that are very best at this exploitation are us. So these are supermodels. Now, supermodels are kind of like supernormal stimuli, except they are real. I mean, these are real people. But if you were to look at the distribution of men and of women, of body size and weight, what you would find is that these supermodels are way, way, way off at one extreme. So Gisele Bündchen, who's a... the wife of Tom Brady, the quarterback for the Patriots. This is before she had children. I mean, this is about 4 or 5 years ago, she's 5'11", weighs 125 pounds, and then was making about $15 million a year. She was the highest paid supermodel at the time. But it seems like it might be that many in society find supermodels, both the men supermodels and the women supermodels, especially attractive because they are so far away from normal. They are so different from average, and this tends to make them attractive. Now, again, these aren't real supernormal stimuli because they're actually persons, but we've been pretty good at creating other supernormal stimuli. And one of the persons who is very good at this is Walt Disney. So if we look at Mickey Mouse, Walt Disney started drawing cartoons when he was in the army during World War II. And the Mickey Mouse that's the farthest on the left is the first image of Mickey Mouse that he drew. And then what we see is that Mickey Mouse evolved. So if we were to look at the Mickey Mouse on the far left, and the Mickey Mouse on the far right, what's some of the biggest differences between those two images? Girls? Go ahead. The skin tone changes, yeah. Mm-hmm. The face looks rounder. Yes, the face looks rounder. Excuse me? The facial expression, the one on the left looks kind of mean and kind of grumpy, and the one on the right looks kind of happy. Any other ideas back there? And the eyes are much, right? They're much, much bigger in the modern Mickey than the old Mickey. Mm-hmm. Last one, go ahead.
Generally more mesomorphic.
Yeah, exactly, and that's the point. That's the point. So what happens here is that Walt Disney is changing the characters of Mickey Mouse over the years to make him look more like a human child. Large eyes, round head, short nose, and making him look a lot less like a rat. More like a human child and less like a rat. And this wasn't intentional. He was just experimenting over the years, drawing this figure and redrawing this figure and redrawing this figure, and finding what variants were more attractive to people watching these movies. And then he ended up with the Mickey Mouse, who was very childlike and very happy. And in the first Mickey Mouse cartoons, Mickey Mouse used to curse a lot. And then he changed that. He changed that very quickly, too. He had him not cursing. So Mickey Mouse is a very famous supernormal stimulus. But when we think about human beauty, there's another very famous supernormal stimulus. Can anyone guess her name? It's Barbie. So it ends up that Barbie and I were born just around the same time. We were both born in 1953. She's aged a lot better than I've aged. And she's been around for a long time. Now, Barbie has changed a bit. But I have six sisters, and I have two daughters, and I've been constantly surrounded by Barbie dolls until my two girls went off to school. So I'm pretty familiar with Barbie dolls. Now, but I wasn't familiar with this fact. If you take Barbie, and if you blow her up to normal size, what you find out is that she's anything but normal. So we see on the left here, they have measurements from a normal person and measurements from Barbie. And if you're to look at these measurements and think about what a real Barbie would be like, what you would find out is that she wouldn't do very well in today's world. So can anybody make some guesses as some disadvantages that a real Barbie would have? Mm-hmm. Exactly. Exactly. She barely has enough mass to stay on the ground. Over here? She what? She wouldn't be able to move her arms very well. Mm-hmm. Well, actually, she'd be, if you make her as tall as a regular person, and behind you? Probably not. So here are some very specific things that Barbie would have problems with. Her necks, her wrists, her forearms, and her ankles, and especially her thighs, are just like matchsticks. I mean, you think she'd be blown away in the wind, and then when she landed, you'd also think that she would just break. Oh, I'm sorry. And then with her super thin and extra long neck, she wouldn't be able to raise her head. So she'd be walking around like this all the time. Her tiny waist would limit her to only half of a liver and only a few inches of intestine. With her tiny feet and her thin ankles, and her top-heavy form, she'd have to walk on all fours. But the lucky thing about Barbie's dimensions is that, thank God, she couldn't reproduce because a baby wouldn't be able to pass through her birth canal because her hips are so slender. But, this is pretty funny, except Barbie's been like this icon of beauty for Western societies for the last 65 years. And this really does cause a lot of problems. A feminist, Naomi Wolf, wrote an article in New York Magazine, and she talked about how society propagates what our ideals of beauty are supposed to be, and most of us, of course, come nowhere near these ideals, and these cause lots and lots and lots of problems, such as eating disorders and image problems in young people as they're growing up. So those are some of the ideas about beautiful sights. What we see is a lot of manipulation of the biases in the brains of female animals and of all of us humans, tugging and tugging at our perceptions of beauty, and sometimes coming up with these really extreme sets of traits, like Barbie, that make us find things attractive that are actually, you know, not very realistic, and even more than a peacock's tail would be very harmful to the individual with those traits. Now, sounds, especially music, but I'm going to talk about frog calls and bird sounds and then human music to give some examples of how sounds are able to be used for sexual attraction and how they're very good at getting inside our brains, the brains of us and the brains of animals, and tweaking these sweet spots in our brain to make us find certain sounds very attractive. Okay, so here's the tundra frog. Now I'm going to play the calls just to remind you of what a whine and whine chuck sounds like. So this is a picture of their call. The part of the sound that's in the blue circle is the whine, and the part of the sound that's in the red circle is the chuck. Now, we have one ear on each side of our head. Frogs have two ears, and each of those ears hear different sounds. So you can see here the blue arrow is pointing to one of these inner ear organs. It's called AP, and the chuck is going to one of these other ear organs called BP. Now, the frog hears both of these sounds with the same two ears, and those ears together then go to the brain. So from studies that we've done in my lab, we know that the best way to activate the auditory centers in the frog's brain, and the best way to activate the parts of the frog's brain that are involved in their reward system is to stimulate those two inner ear organs at the same time. And I'll come back to this in a little bit, because the close relatives of these frogs, they can't make chucks, they can only make whines. So they're only producing sounds that stimulate one of these inner ear organs. Now, birds are really well known for their beautiful songs. Now, this is a musician wren. It's found in Amazonian Peru. And we don't know a whole lot about this species, but what we do know from other species, and this is a zebra finch, is that when female zebra finches hear the male song, as long as they're in a reproductive state, so that's what those red bars show when a female's hormone levels are high, the zebra finch's song stimulates the parts of the brain that are involved in reward. So when the females hear the male song, it triggers these reward centers, the same reward centers which in our brain are triggered by cocaine and gambling and sugar, and it makes the females want to associate with the males making these songs. Now we know in our own species the social importance of music. And this social importance of music extends to sexual attraction as well. So they did an experiment where they played to men music from Mozart and music from Barber, as we'll hear, very different kinds of music. And then they asked the men how this music influenced their romantic feelings. So they asked them how they influenced the romantic arousal in men. So here's the clip that they played from Mozart. And here's a clip from Barber. And when they asked the men how this music made them feel romantically, there's a really strong consensus that it was Mozart's that they found much more romantic than the than the songs by Barber. And what we know in a whole variety of studies and a whole variety of cultural anecdotes, that we use music to tweak certain emotions. We all know how important martial music is when people are going to war, hearing the drums beating, hearing the pipes piping, and it really does stimulate somebody to want to fight. Now, song, like visual displays in fishes, song can also be used in a very deceptive way. So this is a moth that's found in Asia, and it's a very important pest in agriculture, and it's called the Asian corn borer moth. Now, these moths can sing, they can make sounds. Now, below these moth calls, we see pictures of bat calls. Now, the bats, these two species of bats, will feed on the corn borer moth. So the way bats find their prey, besides things like frog-eating bats that just listen for them, the bats make echolocation calls. So they make these clicks and the echoes bounce back. So they'll be flying around looking for insects, making song calls like. Now when they spot a moth and they start to close in on it, then they want to get information back as soon as they can about where the moth is. So they start making these echolocation clicks very quickly and spaced together, and they sound like this. And it's called a feeding buzz. Well, this male's call, the moth's call, sounds like a feeding buzz. So this is what happens. On the left-hand side here, if you take a female and if you play her a bat call, take a female moth, and you play her the call from a bat, she freezes because she doesn't want to move. She wants to stay unnoticed by the bat. And she's so scared that the male can then climb on top of her and copulate with her, and she doesn't move. Well, it ends up that the moths have learned to trick the female. They've evolved to trick the females. The males make their mating call, which sounds like the feeding buzz of a bat. And when the females hear the call of their own male, the females respond as if they're hearing a bat call. So the male calls, the female freezes because she's afraid there's a bat around. She's not going to move even though the male is climbing on top of her and copulating. So animals can use songs in this very deceptive way as well. So a lot of times when we think about animals sending a signal and another animal receiving that signal, we often use the metaphor of a lock and a key. So the lock is the female's brain, and the male signal is the key that can open that female's brain and appeal to her. And if he can open that lock, then she finds him attractive. Well, we also know that there's other ways to open a lock besides having the key that belongs to that lock, and you can pick a lock. And what we've been finding is that there's a lot of examples where animals seem to evolve traits that are able to pick this lock. And we call this sensory exploitation, where males can evolve a brand new trait that the females just happen to be responsive to, that open this lock, but using a very different key, and it makes the males immediately more attractive. So here's a very nice experiment done years ago by a graduate student here, Alex Basolo. And she was working with fishes. On the top picture are swordtails, and on the bottom picture are platyfish. Now, all swordtails have this sword coming off the end, but platyfish don't. Now, there's a lot of species of swordtails and a lot of platyfish, so we know that the sword evolved at the base of all the swordtail species. There's one ancestor that evolved the sword, and then they diverged into many species with swords. And this is after the swordtails diverged from the platys. And we know that all swordtails have preferences for the females prefer males with swords. So the question is, well, when did the preference for sword evolve? If you just always think about the simple lock and key mechanism, you assume that when the sword evolved, they also evolved the preference for the sword. Well, what Alex Bisolo did is she took a platyfish, she took a plastic sword, and she attached it to the platyfish. And she then asked the platyfish females, would you prefer your own male, or would you prefer a male that looked like a swordtail, even though you've never seen a swordtail before? They don't live in the same place. And these are all in northeastern Mexico and Honduras. And what she showed is that the female platyfish actually preferred their males with these fake swords attached. So what that means then is that the preference for swords, since you find that preference in both platyfish and swordtails, that this preference for swords evolved before the sword itself evolved. And we have another example with these tundra frogs. So on the bottom we see the tundra frog with its call, a whine and three chucks. And this map shows the distribution of tundra frogs. They go from Veracruz, Mexico, all the way through Central America, and then they're in Colombia and in Venezuela. And that red arrow shows where we study them in Panama. And to remind you, hopefully by the end of this talk, you're going to remember whine chucks. Now, the top frog is called Physalinus collardorum. And this lives in only a small area of cloud forest in Ecuador on the western side of the Andes. Now, this is what the call of a collardorum sounds like. So they don't add any syllables to their call. It's kind of a whine. It's much shorter. But what we can do is we can take the chucks from the tundra frog, and we can add them to the call of the Colorado frog, and this is what it would sound like. And then we can ask the females, do you prefer the normal male call, or do you prefer the male call that sounds like the tundra frog? And they prefer the call that sounds like the tundra frog. Now, what I'm going to do now is just talk about two examples of where humans and animals have these striking parallels in how they perceive attraction. And we're going to talk about how humans and animals can have very fickle preferences, preferences that change with time, and also how they can be influenced by peer pressure. So Mickey Gilley wrote this country western song a while ago, and he asked, do the girls really get prettier at closing time? And that was the idea in this song. These guys would hang out in the bar all night long trying to meet a woman, and then by the end of the night, everybody looked really attractive to them as the number of women decreased with time. Well, it ends up that a psychologist here, Jamie Pennybacher, conducted a study with humans, and the title of the study was, do the girls really get prettier at closing time? So Pennybacher did this study when he was at University of Virginia, and they went to some college bars in Charlotte, and they asked men and women to rank the attractiveness of people in their gender and people in the other gender at the beginning of the night and then again at the end of the night. And what they found is that both men and women found people of the other gender much more attractive as the bar was about to close than early in the night. And that study was done in the 1970s. Then people were a little critical. They said, but they're drinking all night. So then they redid this study in Australia, where they're drinking all day, but what they did it exactly the same way, except the difference is they took blood samples and they measure the amount of alcohol in the blood. And then statistically, they controlled for variation in blood alcohol, and they got exactly the same result. So we asked one of our graduate students, Kathleen Lynch, a number of years ago, we asked, do the frogs get prettier at closing time? So we're doing this with tundra frogs. Now, one thing that happens with these frogs is that the females come to the breeding pond to choose a male. While they're in the breeding pond, they ovulate. By the end of the night, if they have not chosen a male, if they're not mating with a male, their eggs just come out of their body. They just discharge their eggs. It takes them 6 weeks to develop a clutch of eggs for fertilization. So that's a big waste. So what we did is we brought females into the lab early in the night, and we synthesized some calls, and we made some calls that we knew would be unattractive. So we bring the females in early in the night, and we play these calls, and the females aren't attracted to them. But then we hold the females for another 4 or 5 hours, and then we play them exactly the same calls, and not only did the females find them attractive, they get there so fast, much faster than they would have responded to the most attractive call early in the evening. So these frogs are doing just what the humans are doing. They're changing their standard. They're changing their preferences. They're changing their percepts of beauty through the night. So now the next and the final thing that I want to talk about is peer pressure. So we all know how important peer pressure is. You know, the sports teams that we root for, the music that we like to listen to, the art that we like to see, a lot of that is, whether we admit it or not, a lot of that is influenced by the groups of people that we grow up with. So peer pressure has a big effect on our perceptions of lots and lots of things. So here's a movie clip that I want to show you from this movie, Legally Blonde, with Reese Witherspoon.
So I called your room last night.
I heard.
I was thinking maybe we could go out sometime.
No, you're a dork.
I'm in law school.
Look, I'm not gonna go out with you. I can't believe you'd even ask. Girls like me don't go out with losers like you. Let's get out of here. Excuse me. Why didn't you call me?
What?
We spent a beautiful night together, and then I never hear from you again?
I'm sorry?
Sorry for what? For breaking my heart or for giving me the greatest pleasure I've ever known and then just taking it away?
Both?
Well, forget it. I've already spent too many hours crying over you. When did you want to go out?
So God bless Reese Witherspoon. So you see what happens there, right? The girl in the beginning has no interest in going out with this guy. And then when she sees that another woman's very interested in him, now all of a sudden, well, this guy does appear to be, you know, very attractive, certainly worth me going out with. So we wanted to know if the same thing happened in fish. So we did these experiments with a local fish that we caught down in San Marcos. They're called mollies. And these are the males on the top, right, the more adorned ones, and there's a female on the bottom. And we do this very simple experiment. We put the female in the middle of a tank, and then on either side of a glass partition is a male. And the females will choose one of those males. She'll go over, and the male will court her through the glass. So after we determine which male she prefers, we then put the female back in the middle, and we give each of those males now a female to court, but she cannot see the male who she previously preferred. She can't see him being courted by a male, by a female. But the male that she did not like, that she did not prefer, all of a sudden she looks, and he's got a female who's courting him. So now we remove those barriers so she can see both of the males, and we ask who she prefers now. And now what we find is she changed her preference. So she liked one male when there's only two males there, but now when she sees that the guy she didn't like is being courted by a female, now that male's become much more attractive in her eyes. And we think this is pretty identical to what we just saw in that film clip, where the female's percept of what's sexually beautiful, what's sexually attractive, is influenced not only by her brain, but by the brains of the individuals that they associate with. So I hope I've given you some interesting things to think about in terms of where this taste for the beautiful, this taste for these gorgeous traits that were surrounded by with animals' songs and colors and odors, and that it gives you sometimes a little insights into our own behavior. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mike. And we have time for some questions. And we will take a question from the Slido application. So I think if we go one more, yeah, you can ask your questions here. So the first question here, Mike, comes from Patricia, who asks, do any species of females select for males that offer security, protection for offspring, for example, large muscles?
Yes, yeah, and there's a lot of in species where males afford a lot of care to the offspring, where there's a lot of parental care, then females seem to be able to choose those males who better protect the offspring. So for instance, in some fishes that guard eggs under rocks, this particular kind of fish is called a goby, females will inspect males and then they'll choose the males that have the greater number of eggs on their territory. And the idea is that these males are demonstrating to the females mm-hmm. that he's able to protect the eggs. So then she chooses those males.
Very good. Next question from Anonymous asks, how does food deception work in humans?
I don't think food deception would work in exactly the same way as it does in fish. But we certainly know that food is a very important part of courtship rituals. Mm-hmm. I mean, when people, you know, so many people go on dates to restaurants. I don't think females ever are more attracted to the steak than to the male that's paying for it.
Next question is, can the other senses be used for sexual attraction too?
Yeah, well, we talked about vision and we talked about sounds, but olfaction is a very important sexual attracted, not only in other mammals, but even in our own species. And they've done these experiments where guys wear T-shirts for a few days without showering, and these are called stinky T-shirt experiments. And then they have women smell the T-shirts and rank the attractiveness of the T-shirts. And what they find is that women prefer the odors of men whose immune genes are more different from her immune genes. Which means if you put those together in a child, their immune system would be even more efficient than that of either of their parents. But we don't consciously sniff around trying to find people with good immune genes, but it seems that it does influence our behavior.
Well, speak for yourself. The next question comes from Almaya. She asks, this week, I sadly ended a relationship with a good woman. Just couldn't fall in love with her. I was put off by her voice. Can I lay this off on my biology?
No.
Well, Almaya, thank you for sharing. Seriously. All right, so Justin asks, the chucks from the frogs don't sound or look higher pitched than the whine, but isn't that how the bats are able to locate them?
Now, that's a very good question. The frequency of the chucks are higher. In the whine, the loudest frequency is 700 hertz. In the chuck, the loudest frequency is 2,200 hertz. So yes, it is higher, but a normal bat can't hear much sound below 20,000 hertz. Now these bats are unusual. They have a lot of adaptations in their inner ear that allow them to hear the very high frequencies of their echolocation calls, which are about 60,000 hertz, as well as sounds of frogs, which are usually below 5,000 hertz. So they're not really challenged by telling the difference by being able to hear something that's 2,000 versus 700 hertz. They're pretty sensitive to both those frequencies.
Okay. This question comes from Marcella. It was voted as the most popular question from everybody on the app. is attraction to supermodels not largely due to social conditioning? In other words, always being exposed to supermodels as the epitome of beauty.
Well, no, it is. It is. And that's the point that I was trying to make, that society takes advantage, especially advertising, takes advantage of an attraction to supernormal stimuli in general. And then they exploit that bias that many of us have and turn it into expectations for societal beauty. So yeah, and I didn't mean to suggest that in humans that it was genetically determined that we should find supermodels super attractive, but it's advertising that is able to exploit these biases and create these percepts of beauty that we probably would not have had, quote unquote, in the wild.
Mm-hmm. Right. Next question is, females are the limiting factor and beauty kills. Does this impact the ratio of males to females? Are there more males than females in most populations?
Well, no. Well, it can vary a lot, but in a lot of populations, it's the opposite. Mm-hmm. Because males have these traits that cause early mortality, then in a lot of populations, there will be more females. There will be more females than there are males. But females can still always find a male to mate with them, and that's certainly not true of males. Mm-hmm. So in the tungra frogs, half of the males, when I followed them for a year-long study, half of the males died without ever mating, and all of the females in the study mated a number of times.
Right. Next question comes from Joe. He asks, why are humans reverse with respect to colorful display? Or are they?
Well, or are they? So in humans, there's mutual mate choice. And in some societies, we see that it's really the males that are adorning themselves more than females. And in other societies, it's the females that are adorning themselves. So both things seem to be going on depending on which populations, which societies you're talking about.
Well, this question asks, what advice would you have for a young person in our audience interested in studying biology?
Well, if it's really a burning passion, then it's a great passion to go with, because it's so rewarding to gain a little bit of understanding about the natural world around us and to garner some appreciation for the environment, especially while we have time to still appreciate it.
Nice. Great. And the last question is from Kate. Can you give us a tutorial on the frog call? I kind of feel like you have, but it sounds like they want more.
Well, I'll just do it. I'll do it one more time for you. Or does anybody want to try it?
Yes.
Yeah, come on up.
Ahead,
we'll give you a microphone. Come on up if you want to try it. Mic check. Mic check for the frog call.
Okay. Wait, so how does it go?
Pretty good. Pretty good.
What's your name?
Leia.
Okay, Leia. In return for such an accurate frog call, we have these lollipops that have ants inside of them. You get to choose your flavor. Have you ever had watermelon? Oh, nice choice. All right.
And we can tell there's no tungra frogs in the audience, because if there were, they would have been hopping right up to you.
All right. Thank you very much.